Buonasera a tutti.
Good evening to you all. There is a sentence that emerged in Chicago's political life. Vote early and vote often. He's repeating that in Italian. Vote early and vote often. And we hope that by the next synod we will be able to follow the first part, so vote early and therefore have a briefing session at a decent time. But we are journalists and sometimes we have to work at night and late in general. So having said this, I would like to give the floor for the last time to Paolo. I believe it will be the last time for this synod. So then I'll die immediately, right? Since it's the last time. I apologize for this late hour, but you probably realized that we are so late because the proceedings were wrapped up just a few minutes ago. The voting session ended very soon. You heard also Cardinal Baldisseri and the Holy Father speaking at the end of the synod. And the reading of the document took a longer time than expected because it is a lengthy document. And it was read so that it could be translated by the simultaneous interpreter at the synod, and so this took some time. Well, you have received it in digital form, also the hard copy is now being printed, and you will get that soon. It was approved completely with a majority that exceeded, far exceeded the two-thirds that were needed, more or less far exceeded. And you will see also, number by number, you will see the votes that were cast, so that you will see basically how the Synod Fathers voted on each item. And there was a long round of applause at the end of the vote on the last item. And you probably saw this on the screen. The two special rapporteurs were also the subject of an accolade, and the Secretary General thanked them specifically for the wonderful job they've done. Probably some of you have wondered about this. Actually, these are things that I've wrote down, questions you asked me during all these briefing sessions. And regarding this document that is so rich, what is this document? This was a question that was asked to me. It is a part of the church's teachings or not? The most specific answer was given by the Holy Father in the speech you heard a few minutes ago. This document right now is a document that is addressed to all Synod Fathers and to the Holy Father himself, so that they can all pray, ponder the document, discern, and then the church will continue along its synodal journey. This is the reply to those who asked me whether this document is part of the church's teachings. As you can read in Episcopalis Communion, this is a document that the Synod hands over to the Holy Father. And of course, in these few minutes during this briefing here, for sure, that's not enough for the church to discern. So the church will pray on it and will ponder this document, and then the church can move forward. There are some items that I can highlight. The relationship, for example, between this document and the Instrumentum Laboris and the pre-synod journey, you will find this in number two, I believe. Two and three of the final document. And these numbers two and three mention things that we have already discussed in the synod. So one is the offspring of the other. The Instrumentum Laboris was the foundation of the Synod's discernment work, a very long work that you followed together with us during the last few days. And this this document is the fruit of all this work. First, there was a draft that was presented, and then there were several, there were 360 modi integrations that were suggested. And probably because of this reason, it was so well received by the Synod Fathers. You heard the words of the Holy Father that are much better than the words I've used in all these briefings in explaining why this protected space was needed for the discernment of the Synod Assembly. What is synodality? You will find this 120, 121, 123 on the synodality of the synod process that does not end now, but it will continue in the bishops' conferences, in the individual bishops' conferences, so it will continue in the particular churches. So you will find this three quarters down the document. And the fact of having organized a synod on young people and with young people has reawakened the synodality of the church. Regarding young people, I would like to point out some tangible proposals that are included in point 123, item 123. I will quote this verbatim now. The suggestions of having an effective participation of young people in the co-responsibility of particular churches, the Synod wants to make the active participation of young people effective and ordinary in the places of co-responsibility of particular churches, as well as in the entities of bishops' conferences and of the Universal Church. And the youth office of the Dicastery for the Laity and Family should be strengthened by establishing an international representation body for young people. This is a very tangible proposal. And also at 141, a greater coordination amongst the many offices that deal with young people, of course, with the focus of each specific office, right? We should work more based on unifying projects rather than based on individual, let's say, specialties. The practice of synodality, cum petro, at all levels of the church, and sub petro, you find this at point 119, cum petro and sub petro, where, and I quote here, the commitment to community discernment processes, including also those who are not bishops. Then we have at 119, young people are asking us to walk together. This you find, this actually was very well received as well by the bishops. Another theme on which there were a number of questions. From the standpoint of the structure of the church, what is being suggested? Concerning parishes, point 17 and 18, they reflect the comments made during the synod by some synod fathers on the opportunity of finding solutions that relieve parish priests from administrative issues, let's say, in daily management. Organize parishes in a different way so that priests are relieved from all the red tape and all the administrative tasks that parish priests and have to deal with. Regarding other concrete proposals, one the role of women, 1355, 148, 163. The gist of all these items, perhaps you can see this more in 55. So a greater recognition of the role of women in the presence of ecclesial bodies at all levels, also decision-making levels. I believe that this is 148, I'm sorry. 148, I apologize. Here it is. And a particular importance is the presence of women in ecclesial levels, of women in ecclesial levels. And also women should take part in the decision-making process, fully respecting the ordained ministry. And this is out of justice, which reflects the way in which Jesus interacted with men and women in his time. Regarding sexuality, this too has emerged in your questions in the last few days during the debates that we that took place in the Synod. 38, 39, on sexuality as a gift, the beauty of the Christian vision of corporal reality, sexuality, and also chastity. 149, actually, this is. And then 150, the need for a deeper anthropological, theological, and pastoral analysis of these themes. 150, on the accompaniment of homosexual individuals. On abuse, 29, 30, and 31. On finding the truth and ask for forgiveness, and that no regret can remedy the situation, and also training and prevention are the key. Regarding formation, there are some proposals that refer to the formation and vocation of those who have a vocation to the priesthood, but also lay people. 164, 161, I believe. 164 is focused on the moments when people leave the family of origin to then embrace their final vocation. And I already mentioned that during the debate, the monastic age was mentioned, new ways of interpreting the monastic life, or community life rather than monastic life, as moments of passage. And then 161, the Synod suggests with conviction to all particular churches, religious congregations, movements, associations, and other ecclesial subjects to offer young people an experience of accompaniment in view of discernments. This experience, whose duration should be established depending on context and opportunities, can be qualified as a time dedicated to the maturation of adult Christian life. There should be a prolonged detachment from habitual relations, and it should be built around the experience of shared life with adult educators, and also a strong and meaningful apostolic proposal to be lived together, and a proposal of spirituality that is rooted in life and in sacramental life. In this way, we'll find all the necessary ingredients for the church to provide to young people who are looking for this a profound experience of vocational discernment. Regarding the formation of seminarians and consecrated people, it is being suggested that in the educational team, women are included as well. This is another proposal on abuse. Well, I already mentioned this. Other themes that are also included here are the digital world, how the church should live in the digital world, 21, 22, 23, 145, and 146, where there is a small tangible proposal on the possibility to certify Catholic sites in the digital world. We should find a way to certify whether these Catholic websites are truly Catholic. Migrants, a recurring theme during these last few weeks. 25, 26, 27, 28, 147. And then let's see what else. Of course, the interpreters do not have the text, so that's just incidentally. 164 on priestly formation. Here too, you find very concrete proposals on the selection, and also on the path that seminarians should follow. For the time being, I have nothing more to add. I don't know if you have any questions for me, though. I would like to give you the floor at this point. Anybody else? The Synod is now being printed out. Oh, actually, it's ready. I imagine someone asked for the hard copy.
One moment.
Sorry.
I'm tired, so I...
We're all tired.
Sorry?
So my question is about a point that seems to have gotten the most no votes in the final document, 150, which is on sexuality. I wonder if you could clarify what that document says. It says here that the Synod recommends promoting the accompaniment of the faithful who are homosexual, and among other things, it says that that they should be helped to recognize their desire to belong to a community, and it's up to them to discern the best ways to do that. So I wonder if you could clarify or elaborate on what that means and what the Synod Fathers, what the debate was there, since there were the most no votes on that point.
As you know, today there was no debate. The document was read out, and also the Synod Fathers voted. So I can try with you to tell you what the other points are that talk about these themes. Because if you... reading them together and not just 150 on its own, you can follow what the reasoning was. I do not have my own interpretation to give, because this is a document that was voted on and it was just distributed. I believe that 150, as a matter of fact, is the one that received the highest number of non placet, can be related to 149, that comes immediately prior to 150, where reference is made to the magisterium of the last popes, the Christian vision of corporeality and sexuality, chastity as a value. So I believe that everything should be read in connection to the other points, not in isolation. It should be read with other points that I mentioned earlier, 39 for sure, 38 and 39, that are the first ones that actually refer to the questions coming from young people. Yes, 38 and 39, yes. 39, for instance, the Catechism of the Catholic Church, the theology of the body developed by John Paul II, Deus Caritas Est by Benedict XVI, Amoris Laetitia, with Pope Francis, regarding several themes, including homosexuality. And this is 39. So they should all be read together. 149, 150 already mentioned, sexuality as a gift, 38. Christian families should live sexuality as a gift. So all this perhaps can give an answer to your question, but I cannot really say anything more on this. Is that it? We're done? Are you sure? We heard that there were problems with the translation, with a simultaneous interpretation in the Synod Hall. But the entire document was read out, or just some paragraphs? No, the reason why we're here so late is because the document was read from beginning to end, the first two parts this morning, the third part this afternoon. So the first two parts were read this morning. The vote started this afternoon on part one and two. And then part three was read out, and then the vote took place on part three. There was no issue with the simultaneous interpretation at all in the hall. You realize that also the interpreters had the text, unlike us, quote unquote. So they were also translating from the text, and this required some time. And a funny anecdote, actually, the Secretary General at some point said, translators are basically are in their booths and they waved because the translation of the third part started before the translation of part one and part two. I'm sorry, but just to clarify, the first and the second part, they were read this morning, right? Then there was a break. When they came back from the break, they started voting. Also tried not to forget what had been read. So then the vote was on the third and then on the fourth part. So the Synod Fathers did not have a few hours to then ponder the third part. Well, everybody who spoke Italian had the third part. All those who did not speak Italian, they had that translated, and it was read out, all of it, in one fell swoop, and then they voted. Good evening. Could you please introduce yourself? Luca Mazzanti, Associated Press. In the section that talks about abuse, between 29 and 31, the title is Asking for Forgiveness. However, in those paragraphs, there is no real apology. No one is asking for forgiveness. Where can we find this if it is in the document? Well, here too, I can say that you will find it in all the different paragraphs if you read them all together, because if I read the title is asking for forgiveness, that's asking for forgiveness. When I read no regrets can remedy the situation, this shows how contrite the church is. And that's a request for forgiveness. When I read in point 31, gratitude for all those who are brave enough to then report the abuse they have suffered so that the church can become aware of this. So this means that the church has realized that it had to become aware of this, and the church is grateful to the people who have allowed the church to become aware of this. And also the reading, the letter to the people of God, right? This is a letter that you know. I would say that these three paragraphs together means basically that the church recognizes that it has done wrong and asking for forgiveness and reacting. You heard also what the Pope had to say on this, the difference between the mother church and sinners, right? He mentioned that in the final. My question is, well, I do not know whether there will be an introduction in English when this will be published, more or less. I have no idea. I have no idea, really. Not tomorrow. Well, it will take some time, I imagine. I assume that they will be translated, and you know, it takes time to translate these documents appropriately. Regarding translation, something that I forgot to say is that tomorrow there will be the letter of the Synod to young people, and that will be already available in six languages. So that will be translated, the letter to young people. Well, if there are no more questions, then you can get back to work. And this too is a protected space tonight for about an hour. We're open until 10:30 if you need to work, and you can stick around. Tomorrow there will be no briefing, and I hope you have a wonderful Sunday. And he's wishing you also sin buon pranzo. Well, good lunch. No, maybe have a good dinner, perhaps. Bye, everyone.